have a plan.
Oh, yeah?
What is it?
Is you ready?
Here we go again, huh?
We've been grinding hard on the job. Can't take that from us.
Obviously, you've directed so many things, TV commercials, music videos, series. You know, people might be familiar with Handmaid's Tale, but if you could explain The Falcon and Winter Soldier and the genres it hits, what would be that mismatch of genres that this show covers?
What I've done in my past, I look at them kind of all, even though they all are different for what the skill set is, because obviously an action genre piece is by definition you're diving into a particular kind of world, and as a result need to know certain things. Like there's technical there's a technical side to it that is part of what I do, but I kind of look at it all as serving story. So drama can be violent in its own way, even if it's not physical violence. It can be emotional violence or so I kind of blend it in my head. I don't feel like the work is so diversely different. I feel like the work kind of has sort of similar themes and similar, I approach it similarly, even as I break it down though, if the results, like a Handmaid, is so very different from this series. But what I've really enjoyed in Falcon and Winter Soldier is kind of bringing all of that, my comedy side, my action side, my drama side, all of it is working full tilt. So all the pistons were firing.
How has been working just with Marvel for you, a new experience, but also being a part of a superhero property? How has that been for you as a director?
Well, it's terrific. First of all, it's a great deep dive. You have a lot of resource material, so you can always go, you're very informed. But it's so much fun because you can do extraordinary things. In this case, we have a wonderful relationship that we get to explore, which has not been explored on screen before. So, unlike some of these kinds of movies where it's, new day, new adventure, this is actually new day, new characters. Like Bucky and Sam are new to us, really. We've never seen them like this. We've never gotten to know them the way we get to know them in this storyline. So, that to go into new turf like this has been really extraordinary. And I think new for the, for Marvel and Kevin and gang as well. They've really enjoyed it.
Yeah, you make a great point because we've only been exposed to them in a movie sense, and where the focus has maybe been on larger than life characters like Iron Man and Captain America. Now we get to be really intimate with these. This is a 6-episode series. I guess from what we've heard, the episodes are roughly around 45 to 55 minutes. So let's say maybe about an hour, you get about 6 hours of content. So you really get deep into these characters out of the gate. I mean, we get a great action scene. So people that were like, need to be fueled by that action, they get that. But jumping into these characters out of the gate, hitting upon themes like PTSD, grief. Can you kind of talk about some of those themes that you're really able to dig deep with Sam and Bucky?
Well, the first scene, the first theme that we hit hard on is racism. We're really, it's about what does it mean for a Black man to pick up the shield? And we really explore that. Sam really explores that as he's pondering whether he will or whether he won't. Because, he starts at the end of Endgame, he says, well, it doesn't feel like mine. And it doesn't feel like his, in part because of his friend being Cap. And, Chris was Cap to Sam, Steve was Cap to Sam as well. So, there's a dynamic of the grief of the loss of a friend, but there's also, it doesn't feel like mine because do I want it? And so it's his exploration of what that will mean to us, as a Black man, to the Black community and to the white community. We explore, what is it to be a hero? What is that definition of a hero today versus what it was when Steve actually picked up that shield way back? Because 80 or some odd years has passed. Mm-hmm. So, and times have changed. And the definition of a hero has evolved from being a soldier warrior to also being a first responder. And so that's a very different, you know, that's something to consider in amongst all of this, the relevance of these iconic symbols. And Bucky is, you know, dealing with mental health, PTSD. Mm-hmm. Yes, he might have his mind back, but what does that mean going forward? Because he's going to have to cope with guilt. He's going to have to cope with victims because he left an awful lot of victims. The collateral damage as a result of his actions is something that is going to haunt him. And he has to either get to somehow reconcile it in order to be able to move forward. So, you know, these are very complex issues and themes that are embedded within the fun. I mean, we get to tell it with ironic humor and you know, so it when we get heavy, we do get heavy, but we also never shy from a laugh.
Yeah, I think it's kind of, you know, I've been able to see the first episode like a lot of us, and you really can see how deep of a dive that you're going into. And, you know, just being able to basically form an even tighter relationship with these characters. Storytelling is about the characters at heart. We have all the spectacle, but these characters, there's a lot of stuff in there that I feel you scratched a little in the first episode, but I got to imagine it's only going to go deeper and deeper.
Of course. I mean, that's the wonderful side to storytelling over 6 hours as we just get to keep going.
Yeah, I just had one more question to ask. Timeline is a big thing in the Marvel Universe, meaning where does everything fall? Sam mentions this falls roughly a few months after everyone comes back. Can you just really touch upon where maybe exactly does this story fall? And then we haven't really seen the Avengers or these characters who are all separated now acknowledge each other. Do they know what's going on with each other right now?
I would say that they, right now in our story, they are very focused on what they have to do. So we are 3 months after the blip, everyone's returned. The borders have been, you know, murky because while the blip was happening, much like, you know, the pandemic, everyone was cooperating at a different level. Obviously half the population was gone. So, there was, you know, mass grief alongside mass, you know, reorientation of everything. It was globally a massive change. And then, boom, they all came back. And so when they all came back, it was a sort of a version of chaos. Yes, there was the exuberance of 5 years not knowing what was going to happen. And then, boom, people come back. So there's at first, I guess there would have been mostly tremendous joy. But now we're past that. We're now into the next phase of the world trying to figure out what it needs to be going forward. And some of that has to do with, of course, people wanting to turn the clock back. The people who blipped back didn't really know that they blipped out. So they were just suddenly, they don't feel the time of it. So for them, they want things to go back as they were. And that sort of, as we go into it, you can see via even our first big action sequence that the world, and I think we have someone even says, you know, the world's a crazy place. Allies are now enemies, and enemies are now allies. And so, you know, that as a result of that, lots of stuff happens.
All right. Well, you know, I just want to say thank you again, Kari, for everything. Really appreciate your time, and can't wait to watch the rest of the series.
Terrific. Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
So we're partners, co-workers.
Not necessarily a team.
No. We look damn good, though.